Welcome to Chubb Global Insights. I'm David Furby. Today, my guest is Lord Charles Powell, a British diplomat, businessman, and advisor to Chubb. Lord Powell, you were private secretary and advisor on foreign affairs and defence to two UK prime ministers, Margaret Thatcher and John Major. You left No. 10 Downing Street in 1992 after 9 years and have since served as a board member of several major international companies, as well as being an independent member of the House of Lords. Thank you for joining me today in these unusual times when we are both conducting this interview from our homes during lockdown.
Well, David, it's nice to be with you.
Let's start with Brexit. Now that the UK has left the EU and a trade deal negotiated, what does the landscape look like? And what are the risks and opportunities for both the UK and multinational businesses?
The answer is it's a bit early to tell yet about the implications and consequences of Brexit. You may remember that the Chinese Premier, Chou Enlai, was once asked what he felt about the consequences of the French Revolution. And he said, well, it's a bit early to tell. Well, we shan't need 200 years to tell about Brexit, but we probably need a year or two before we can really, really understand the consequences. That, in a way, has been amplified by the coronavirus, because that has made life so different and so difficult in the short term. And it's a bit hard to disentangle what's the consequence of the virus and what's the consequence of Brexit itself. But having said that, there's some things are pretty clear. It's not the end of the world, and it's not salvation. It's somewhere in between. It's pretty clear that the British economy will, over the next few years, be smaller than it would otherwise have been, by which I mean it won't perhaps necessarily grow as fast as it might have done otherwise, because of the interruption of the trade flows. And the ability of people to travel as easily as in the past. So that will be different. And companies will need time to understand how to adapt to the new situation. They need to understand the very complex rules and regulations about trading with the rest of Europe. And the same will be true of European companies trying to trade with the UK. So I suppose what I'm saying is there's going to be a shakedown period, which might last anything up to a year, while people readjust. One thing that I would say, and this actually struck me as really rather interesting, is that after years of Brexit being on the front page of every newspaper, just about every day, you have to search through to page 5 or 6 these days to find any reference to Brexit. I mean, it's either it's all about the virus, or it's all about Harry and Meghan or something like that. But Brexit has faded as a sort of daily issue, and that itself is quite interesting, because it suggests, I say, no panic, but things need adjusting rather than cataclysmic change.
You mentioned that the British economy is going to, in all likelihood, shrink in the coming years. The City of London and Wall Street have been the world's leading financial centres. What do you see for the future of the City of London post-Brexit?
Let me first just correct one point. I didn't say it would shrink. I said it wouldn't grow as fast, and that as a result, it would probably be 3 or 4% smaller, let's say, in 10 years' time than it would otherwise have been. So I don't think we're not waving goodbye to growth. But people took a conscious decision by a small majority. They took a decision. They preferred to regain more of their national sovereignty than grow as fast as they might otherwise have done. And you have to respect that decision. The Remainers hated it, but that was what the majority wanted. Now, coming on to the city, well, of course, the city is a hugely sophisticated, well-developed institution. It's built up over centuries. It has enormous networks, not just in London itself, but, of course, with Europe and the United States, Japan, Hong Kong. London is a global market. Nowhere else in Europe is a global financial market. Oh, they would like to be, but they aren't yet. And let me just tell you one small fact. More people work in the small square mile of the City of London than live in the whole of Frankfurt. Now, that tells you something. That tells you about the concentration of skills and abilities that exist in the City of London. That's not going to change. if the Europeans want to make difficulties on financial services, well, maybe they will, to try to regain a bit more of the business for themselves. But I'm absolutely confident that London will remain one of the four global financial centres, alongside New York, alongside Tokyo, and alongside Hong Kong.
More broadly, relating to the UK, what part should the UK play on the world stage?
Well, that's a very big issue, and it's actually quite a good time to ask it, because the British government published just 2 days ago what it calls the Integrated Review of Foreign and Defence Policy. And this is aiming to set out what Britain will look like in the world after Brexit. The tagline is, we're going to be global Britain. Not precisely clear what that means, but it means, I think, that we have to look not just to Europe, but to the whole world. Though I would say we've been doing that anyway. It'll become perhaps more of a necessity. So I believe that Britain will continue to play a role in the politics, security, and defence of the world, alongside the United States above all. They are, after all, our closest partner. And amongst their partners, we are the only one with the same degree, or with a sufficient degree of sophistication in our defence, our military equipment, and everything like that. And if I was being slightly simplistic about it, I would say, well, the United States is the world sheriff. Britain will continue to be the deputy sheriff, because that suits our instincts. We've always been outward looking. We've always been involved right round the world, and still are through the Commonwealth and many other ways. So Britain will still be a very active world power. Of course, it doesn't have the weight, scale, and size of the United States or of China, or indeed of the European Union. But we do still have the instincts and the ambitions to play a global role. Do you know, I don't really see those quite so much in the European Union. Of course, it's going to be great in its economic size and its trade reach, that too. But it doesn't really have that sense of destiny which drives Britain and always has done, and the sense of ambition. So for me, we are going to go on playing a leading and active role in the world. And of course, trade and business will be a very, very big part of that. Trade with every part of the world. We'll be signing up trade agreements wherever we can and expanding our exports, not just of goods, but above all of services.